Man, that was the funniest dang thing. I seriously thought there was something in my damn can of Coke. I'm on the mountain in New Zealand, what was a less than a week ago, and I pull out this little, all the sodas are like in little bitty cans. I mean, you can't even buy like a normal size can of soda over there. So all the cans were like super small, and I shake it and go, I'm like, what in the heck? Oh my gosh, I literally thought it was a finger in there. Just a piece of ice on the bottom.
The intersection of good drinks, good music, and good times. This is Hops and Spirits Bar Conversations.
I know you heard me say a while back it was our third anniversary of the podcast this month. It's wild to think that this has been going on for 3 years. That's right. We dropped our very first episode of Hops and Spirits back on June 12th, 2020. That's right, June 12th, 2020. Since then, we've done a few more podcasts, officially 149. With this one, although there's a few extra out there, a couple special ones that we've done along the way. But 149th episode today, or this one, whenever you're listening to it, we've got a lot in store for episode 150 and some great guests moving forward from there, and also some changes to the podcast, and kind of the changes start a little bit on this one. You know, you normally after I do my little quick intro, I kick it over to our Tasting Notes segment with whether that's with Chad Watson, Allison Settle, Kevin Patterson, Jake Solik, and so many others to talk about all things beer, whiskey, cocktails, and food. But that won't happen this week, and it won't happen moving forward as we're retiring Tasting Notes for the time being. It's been a lot of fun talking to them. They've been so great, giving us so much information. If you're worried about not hearing them, don't worry. Chad, Allison, Kevin, and Jake, and others will be moving to our sister podcast, the Hops and Spirits Kentucky podcast, where we'll be able to dive in a little bit deeper. And all those folks are based in Kentucky, too, so it kind of makes sense there. But don't worry, we're still going to have some fun on the Bar Conversations podcast. We'll still be talking with some of your favorite artists, some new artists, maybe some that you haven't heard of as well, whether it's country music, Americana, country rock, southern rock, or maybe a little bit outside of that as well from time to time. That won't change. Like I said, we'll be doing a few other things, and you'll notice a few more things, especially if you watch us on Facebook or YouTube, because the video will be trying to have a little bit more fun there as well. But like I said, the conversations are going to continue because those are my favorite parts, and we'll have a little bit of fun there as well. And in the meantime, don't forget to check out our sister podcast. Like I said, Hops and Spirits Kentucky. It talks about all things booze, food, fun, and arts and more here in Kentucky. It's a great chat. This past week, we talked with New Riff's new CEO. We've talked with all sorts of folks from the alcohol industry and restaurant industry. So whether you're visiting, live here, or from here, I highly recommend that one. Or if you're more into just getting some bourbon reviews and news and things like that, check out our Neat and Mixed series with Brandon and myself, where we review different bourbons and whiskeys, sometimes tequilas, maybe some añejos. I can say it, I promise. If you've seen that video, you don't want to miss those. Those drop on our social media every week at Hop Spirits on TikTok, Facebook, Instagram, and so many others that are out there. And you can get more at hopspirits.com. But I don't want to waste any more time. Like I said, a lot more will be happening with episode 150 next week. But up next, for the second time, it's Lucas Hoge. He's got new music. His show is back for a new season, and it's just a blast to talk to him. Enjoy.
Did you know Hops and Spirits is more than just this podcast? Check out hopspirits.com for our latest episode release, past episodes, interviews with interesting folks in the alcohol industry, and so much more. Just go to hopspirits.com. Feel free to wait until this podcast is done.
Joining us here for our conversation, he's back again. It's the second time here on the podcast. He's a chart-topping country artist, host of the Sportsman Channel series Hoge Wild, which is, when this is out, not when we're talking, but when this is out, the new season will be out. Welcome in, Lucas Hoge.
26th of June, season 4 premiere. Cheers to that.
Now, I always ask this question, and I clearly see you have a drink. So, what are you drinking tonight?
I'm drinking the new Uncle Nearest Rye whiskey.
Ooh.
Yeah, it's so good. Super smooth. I wasn't a huge rye until I had this, and this is good stuff.
Well, that's fitting, then, that I grabbed a rye. Went with a little chicken cock rye.
Man, I've not had that.
I literally just popped it. So, so rye is something that you're just getting into now. Bourbon before that. Where were you at?
Yeah, so just single barrels and, you know, regular bourbon like that. And then I fell in love with that's just honestly their whiskey. I wasn't a huge whiskey guy before. I mean, it was wine and tequila and beer for me. I mean, that was pretty much it. And then when I met Vaughn and Keith, the founders of Uncle Nearest Whiskey, we had a dinner one night downtown, and obviously that's all I was drinking was Uncle Nearest Whiskey, you know. And I was like, man, at the end of the dinner, I'm like, I really like this. And they're like, well, here's a couple more bottles, try these. And I was like, oh yeah, heck yeah, it's on.
I like it. See, that's just how you end up figuring it out. Because I wasn't a rye guy at first, but now I love it. And to me, it's sweet. Everyone else says rye is spicy, but to me, it's sweet.
This has a sweet, like almost like an almondly buttery finish almost. And you can definitely taste the barrel in it, but man, I love it. Really do.
Now, you said tequila, bourbon, beer. I'm guessing you mix them all in there every now and then, depending on where you're traveling to.
Absolutely, man. You know, I'm always a cocktails before wine kind of guy, and then if I'm on beer, it's pretty much beer all night long. But it's cocktails before beer for sure, and it's usually tequila or bourbon, and then I move into like wine depending on what we're having for dinner. And yeah, I'm kind of a wine snob when it comes to that stuff. I blame my friend Tom Gamble. Again, I wasn't a huge wine guy at all, and when I first moved to Nashville, I hated wine. I mean, I just hated the taste of it. And my buddy Eddie Kay, who was one of the founding members of Ricochet at the time, who had the long mullet, you know, the keyboard player. And every time I'd come over to his house, he'd hand me a glass of wine. And I kind of, you know, I couldn't say no, right? I was like, yo, this is so good. Yeah, I, like stumbling all the way down. And after about 6 months of me coming over to his house and writing probably once a week and stuff like that, I developed a taste for it. And one night he didn't have any wine. And I was like, dude, where's my wine? He's like, oh man, I'm all out. Well, we got to go to the store, get in the truck.
I love that. I was going to say, I wasn't much of a wine fan. My wife really isn't. She's kind of gotten into it, but we went down to Patagonia in February, and down there it's just meat and wine and some cheese. That's you know, that's all you're having for your meal for the most part. And
right. And
so we got into Malbecs, and now I actually like red wine. And before that, it was like super sweet white, and then I jumped all the way to red.
Yeah, like Sauvignon Blancs and Sauternes, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. So I did the full thing. Now, speaking of drinks, I saw on, I think it was Instagram or social media, how good was that Coke down there that you weren't sure what was in it?
Man, that was the funniest dang thing. I seriously thought there was something in my damn can of Coke. I'm on the mountain in New Zealand, what was a less than a week ago, and I pull out this little, and all the sodas are like in little bitty cans. I mean, you can't even buy like a normal size can of soda over there. So all the cans were like super small, and I shake it and go, ding, 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 ding. I'm like, what in the heck? Oh my gosh, I literally thought it was a finger in there. Just a piece of ice on the bottom. Tasted just like Coke.
I was going to say, you just risked it. It didn't matter.
Yeah, I don't have a cup to pour it in. I'm just going to go for it. See what happens.
Now, you also got to travel recently as well. You're in Belize for the first Belize Songwriter Festival. How was that trip?
Oh, man. So awesome. Belize is one of my favorite places to go now. I mean, I started going there last year, and I filmed an episode down there. Choose Belize, which is a great company who has different properties all across Belize that you can, you know, go stay at, whatnot. And I partnered up with them for this episode, and I brought two songwriter buddies of mine down. And, you know, about when we started talking about going down there, I said, you know, I'd love to maybe do a impromptu songwriter round at the lodge that we're staying at and just see what happens, maybe advertise it for a week or, you know, a handful of days before we get down there. And man, the reception was overwhelming. I mean, there was probably 150, 200 people. And we're talking Hopkins Beach, which is still kind of remote, you know, just now starting to come into its commerciality with lodges and resorts and hotels and things like that. So it's very local still. But there is a huge expat, what they call expatriates down there, that have gone down there to either retire or just, you know, change of pace, whatnot. So they all showed up in droves for this little songwriter round that we did that night. And I look over at my other partner and I was like, man, there's something here. So we decided to start the Belize Songwriter Festival. And it was a huge success this year. Got amazing partners. And we're already talking to them for next year. We're starting, you know, tentatively May 17th and 18th of next year will be the Songwriter Festival. You got to come down, man. Do a podcast. Dude, it's insane.
I would be down for it because that would be my birthday weekend.
Come on. Oh, perfect, dude. Stay at Jaguar Reef. That's where everybody's staying. And they've got the most crystal clear, gin clear blue waters I've ever seen in my life. And I've been all over this world. I've been to Costa Rica, everywhere. And there's nothing like these waters, man. And it could be the worst day in Belize and it's still gorgeous, you know? And, you know, the only thing that is a bummer sometimes is when the sargassum comes in. It's that kind of seaweed that, you know, floats through. It's kind of seasonal. So you never know when the winds are going to change from Africa and it blows it in from there. And sometimes it hits at the wrong time. But, man, once you get, like, past, I don't know, a mile past the beach sometimes, it is just crystal clear blue water. I mean, 100-foot visibility when you're scuba diving and stuff like that. It's just crazy.
That is amazing. And I think that's what I've loved now that I've started to travel a little bit. My wife has been pushing for that for a while. Like I said, we went to Patagonia and Argentina and Chile, and you know, we're looking at a couple other trips for next year. We got any other fun stories from your travels? Any good ones that you can tell that, you know, won't get you in trouble anywhere?
I mean, like I said, I've been traveling all this country. I mean, not only for the TV show Hoge Wild, the series, but during my music career too, I've been traveling all over the world. I mean, with the USO and AFE tours to Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iraq, Kuwait, Kosovo, Egypt, I mean, Hawaii, you name it. And I've fished in a lot of these places too. And this year, finally, had the best day of my life fishing out on the open water. It was incredible. I was down there at Crocodile Bay Resort in Costa Rica, Port Jimenez. And, you know, it's usually a good 8-hour boat ride with maybe a few snags on something nice, right? This year was record year, man. We go out and we're out there for, I don't know, 30, 40 minutes, and rods are bent to the water, man. We're getting 400-pound black marlin, 375-pound blue marlin, almost a 6-foot Dorado. I mean, rooster fish, Jack Crevalle, you name it. I mean, just like this episode's just going to be catching, you know, finally an episode of catching instead of fishing and boat rides.
Well, that's more what it's always like for everyone else.
Check out Hops and Spirits on social media at Hops Spirits, all one word, on Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, and Twitter.
Get enough fish.
You can also find Hops and Spirits on YouTube and at HopSpirits.com.
This is the first episode that is just like, holy cow, amazing, amazing catch down there. We hit it right.
Well, it sounds like that was a good time. And for those that don't know, how in the world did you end up hosting a TV show on the Sportsman Channel?
Well, I mean, and I attribute it to, obviously, my music. Started growing up in a small town where that's all I did was hunt and fish and go to school and play sports. And before school and after school, we'd set traps and, you know, for coons and coyotes, whatever we could catch. And that just stuck with me. I mean, that's part of my life, you know. So I wanted to keep that with me wherever I went, you know, promoting conservation and hunting and trying to get other, you know, the youth back into outdoor sports and things like that, because it's kind of tapering off a little bit. And it's just something that was near and dear to my heart and something I love to do, period, the end, you know. But when I started traveling for music and going on tours, I'd do all these great shows and, you know, either people be backstage or fans or doing meet and greets, and I'd meet these people because I was always talking about, you know, going hunting or fishing during my set and singing about it. And all these people would come and be like, man, I didn't know you liked to hunt, or, you know, I'm glad you like to fish and all this stuff. And I do this thing every year, so-and-so here and there. I'm like, don't ever invite me on something if you don't truly want me to show up. My butt will be there 30 minutes early or a day early, 'cause I'm ready to go, man. That's how it started, man. I was, I, I, I granted this lady her dying wish out in Pueblo, Colorado. Gosh, I want to say back in 2016, 17, 18, somewhere around there. It's all starting to blur together. And one of her friends that was by her bedside was, you know, talking to me, and he's a big elk hunter, and I'd never been elk hunting at the time. And he's like, "You bow hunter?" I'm like, "Man, I'm just kind of starting getting into it. I've only been bow hunting for about 3 years, so I still feel like a newbie every time I go out, but I love it, you know?" And he's like, "Well, if you want to come out, I'll take you elk hunting." And I said that exact thing. I was like, "Don't invite me if you don't want me to show up, because I'll be there." And literally he called me, and we set it up, and man, it was off to the races. And been elk hunting with him pretty much every year since. And same where across the world, like, friends would introduce me to their friends who know somebody who can take you there, this and that. And that's how I met a lot of the people that I've been hunting in New Zealand and Africa and all that stuff, are friends who've been over there that know these people. So it's just been one of those, you know, labors of love that I can't say no to, because it's just in my bones. You know, I just love doing it, and I love bringing people along with me. And I say my guitar has been my passport. It just takes me all over the world, because if it wasn't for my guitar, I wouldn't be able to do any of this stuff. Because that's where I've met everybody, is at shows or playing a songwriter night or something, you know.
So, and like you said, be careful. You get invited, you will show up.
I will. And if I invite somebody, you damn well better show up too.
That is fair. And now I'm going to ask you a really tough question here. What do you enjoy more, playing music or being in the outdoors?
Gosh, that's so tough, man.
Or is it playing music in the outdoors?
Always the best, right? It's the trifecta right there. Yeah, I mean, it really is hard to say which one's better than the other. They're amazing in their own differences, if that makes any sense at all. Being on stage and performing for people, I love doing that. And I love sitting around a fire or a small intimate setting and just playing songs that I don't get to play normally from stage. It's like those intimate, you know, ballads or songs, that story songs that you don't get to sing as much. I love doing that more than anything, but I just love traveling this world and get to see it from every nook and cranny that there is to offer, and meeting amazing friends now all across the world. It really is. I mean, I feel like I could, you know, fly over to wherever, it could be New Zealand or Africa, and I could break down and we'll figure out how to get me back to the States. You know, it's like I've got friends all along the way. Oh, my buddy's got a ship. He'll let you go on and change the oil in it or something. You know, it's like all that kind of stuff. Like, it's just meeting friends along the way. And, you know, that's what it's all about. Friendships, relationships, and adventure. You know,
it's amazing what a conversation can do, right?
Amen. Absolutely right.
Now, is there any place you haven't, like, checked off your bucket list, or any, like, try going a place to fish, hunt, or even just go, like, you know, like, I mean, have you checked off every continent yet?
Not yet. I mean, I'm just scratching the surface, man. I'm just getting rolling. You know, I've been to New Zealand a couple times now, and we're so close to Australia. And Australia is one of those places that I've always wanted to go. Even as a kid, I think one of my, like, book reports or one of those reports that you have to do in grade school, like, with all the drawings, I think I still have that. It was about Sydney, Australia, you know, and all it has to offer. And I would love to go there and figure out how to either dive the reef and maybe do some hunting there for water buffalo or something. But, yeah, I've actually got a card here from a guy. I literally picked it up today, going to Australia. So I'm putting it out there. That's where I want to be next year. So hopefully.
You got to put it out there in the universe, and then it'll come true.
Exactly, man.
Now you mentioned you grew up in a small town, and on the last episode last year we kind of got into this, but I love the story of how they helped you get to Nashville, because that is so true small town. Can you tell that story?
Yeah, you know, I've been playing and music for years, and in, you know, high school I'd sing with my dad and my brother, and we'd help raise money for different organizations around town, whether volunteer, whatever. And never expected anything. We were just, you know, singing to sing. Somebody wanted to hear us sing. Yeah, we're going to sing for you. You know, that type of deal. And we'd always do these little events at the theaters or wherever. And the day finally came where I was like, you know what, I'm going to give this a shot if I'm going to go to Nashville. And I want to do a big see you later, bye, you know, for the town and whoever wants to come. And And our little auditorium there in Chester, Nebraska, where we go to high school, was, you know, a nice little spot. I think it only holds like, it holds more than the town has population. I know that. And we packed that place, man. It was standing room only. And, you know, I brought in a bunch of other, you know, artist buddies of mine that were in the area. And my brother sang, my dad sang, I think my girlfriend at the time sang. And we were, you know, had my buddy who played piano played. I mean, just whoever wanted to come and sing some songs and help raise money to get my broke butt to Nashville. I think the Women's Club and those kinds of organizations came together, and they made quilts and sold like baked goods and whatnot and that kind of thing. It was really cool, man. And my mom had a quilt made, and everybody was signing it in the back. Like, you know, I still have this quilt. It's really cool. There's thousands of signatures on it, and just people wishing me goodwill, and it was fun to have that. But yeah, I think we raised like $2,500, and I was able to get my first apartment down in Antioch, Tennessee. That's the only place I could afford at the time, and that's kind of the short and long of it. I guess it was pretty. I think did like a 2-hour concert with all my friends, and had a great time.
I was going to say, it's amazing what a small town can do. And I also love too, that you know, obviously country music's kind of where you're at these days, but you had a Southern rock band and a worship band in college.
Yeah. So right out of high school, I was asked to front, the band Southern Cross. And I think they're still playing like in the Nebraska Midwest area. And then while I was in college, I went to the tech school in Milford there. And I'd drive to Lincoln every Wednesday or Thursday, whatever it was, for a worship night, you know, at the Lutheran Chapel there on campus. And I was the drummer there for a while, for Extreme Devotion. I don't know what they're doing anymore, still around or not, but yeah, I was hitting it all at all angles, man. I was sinning during the week and praising Jesus on the weekend.
It's a good balance. A good balance.
Right. You got to have it all. Right.
Now I was gonna say, what did you grow up on that, you know, was kind of the music that you loved, or maybe that just kind of stuck with you to this day?
I'll be honest with you, it was literally every single genre, and I was saturated with it because I was the youngest of four, so I had two older sisters and an older brother and mom and dad, and every time we'd go somewhere, if we weren't like singing our own songs in the car, I'd have to listen to whatever they wanted to listen to. So it was anywhere from rock music to country music. And then, you know, growing up, I was farming. So whoever was, you know, playing whatever in the tractor and stuff, and you know, we had to listen to whatever. I felt like I never got to touch the dials on a radio until I turned like 16, 17. I was like, no, this is mine. Don't touch my radio. But I was literally listening to everything. And then I think my senior year of high school, I took an extra job, like cleaning the floors and stuff and refinishing the wood floors for gymnasiums for schools and stuff. And my buddy, Everett Roop, he loved listening to like 50s, 60s, like malt shop music. You know, so I got that like education in 50s music, like doo-wop stuff, man. So I was getting a hit from every angle, and I fell in love with it all. You know, there was nothing that I was like, oh my God, this is amazing, until I heard Garth Brooks. And Garth's music was something that was like, okay, this feels like kind of like rock and country and a little soul all kind of slammed into one, you know? So I was like, this is cool, you know? I'm not just hitting one particular genre. And that's kind of what started getting me into listening to more country music. And that's what opened my mind up to, oh, who's writing these songs? You know, that's who I really gravitated towards, was the songwriter. And when I found out it was like Paul Overstreet and Skip Ewing and Michael Peterson and all these guys that were not only amazing artists on their own right, but they were writing the hits for all these big artists, I was like, dude, that's cool. How do I become that guy? You know, how do I jump on that train? You know? But so it was pretty fun. You know, that's kind of what my musical, I guess, repertoire was, just getting slapped in the face with everything playing around.
Well, and I think that shows up with the songs that you do write and the songs that you do put out. So where does that, what goes into writing a song for you, or picking a song?
You know, picking a song is easy because it's like, I have to hear it. I'll listen to thousands of songs, you know, I'll put them in my truck and I'll just rip it. And I can know within the next like 30 seconds if I'm like, no, sorry, that's too old or that's dated or that's not going to fly these days, whatever. I can write better than that type thing, you know, that kind of thing. And then I'm constantly writing all the time, you know, when I'm not touring or off the road or, you know, not shooting the show, I'm always trying to write, get in the studio and record as much as possible. We're trying to do that right now is write and record for something in the fall to come out. But yeah, it's easier. I mean, it's easier to pick a song than it is to write my own song and like it.
Your harshest critic.
Great song. You just wrote a great song. I'm like, yeah, I think it can be better. You know, mind screw something forever. You know.
Now, did you write Duck Blind, or was that one that you found?
Oh, no, I wrote that one.
So where did that one come from?
I was having an honorary day, and I was like, you know what, screw it. I think I just got back from a duck hunt in Arkansas, and man, it was fun, and it was close to the end of the season, so there wasn't a ton of ducks, but man, I'd never seen a duck camp like this ever before in my life, and it was a private camp, so you couldn't even pay to go there. You have to be invited to come. And it was gorgeous, man. I mean, just insanely gorgeous. The biggest duck blind I've ever seen. It was three stories, has a living room in it with like big screen TVs and you know, a full kitchens and it's three stories. And they have got theater seating out there for you to, you know, chill out in until the ducks come. I mean, just crazy, crazy. And so I was like, man, if there was a duck blind ever that you could get something going, have a party in, was that. So kind of wrote it around that.
If you haven't, you need to listen to that song. It is a fun song. Now, your latest single is Nowhere, and I think I've had that on my playlist for a good while. Good. How did that one come to be?
That's actually a song that that was pitched to me by my producer, Jason Massey, pitched that song to me accidentally. So it was already on hold by like another artist here in town that they would never tell me who it was. So it was probably a decent sized artist. And, man, I literally heard that's the first song he sent. And he calls me probably 4 minutes after he sent the emails like, hey, don't listen to the song that says Nowhere on it. I can't pitch that. And of course, that's the first song you listen to. You're like, well, why not? Boom. And I fell in love with it. It took me a year and a half going after the songwriters, publishers, talking to everybody that owns a piece of that song. I'm like, hey, I have to record this song. I mean, that's where I'm from. It's Nowhere. I was sending them pictures of the gas station, you know, in our local area that literally has like Nowhere. You're in Nowhere, you know, Nebraska. And they're like, finally, I just beat them down. You know, it's just like, I have to have this song. I have to have this song. And when I finally was able to get permission to record the song, because that takes thousands of dollars, right, just to go in and record. I had my whole entire tour set up for Hoge Wild, and I knew I was going to be in New Zealand, Costa Rica, Belize, Louisiana, New Mexico, Puerto Vallarta, all these places. I was like, boom, I'm going to shoot a music video in every location that I filmed for Hoge Wild, and we're going to make it one music video, so it's going to look like we spent a gazillion dollars on this thing because we're in all these exotic locations. And, you know, it didn't, which was really cool. I think it turned out really, really well. And it was just a really fun song to be a part of. And I'm thankful to Lo Cash and Drew Baldridge and Jason Massey, who wrote the song, who finally gave me permission to cut it. So that's fun.
Well, I was going to say, it's a great song, and the video is awesome as well. I mean, how much fun was it to shoot that all over the world?
Oh, my gosh, it was so cool. I mean, thinking about the end result every time and the fact that you could – Every music video we did stand alone, so we could do an entire one, you know, wherever we were at, and to be able to put them all together, and it really looks spectacular. Like, I mean, go to all those places and shoot full long length music videos. It's pretty unreal.
And then you know, you mentioned you were doing the show, but you also just got off tour recently with Chapel Hart on their Glory Days tour.
Yeah.
How was that?
Oh, it was fun, man. They're girls, and we had a lot of fun out there. I actually filmed an episode with them. I took them on their first turkey And it was fun. They're very, very chatty. So it's hard to get them to kind of zip it and be like calm and quiet and not move around. And it was unfortunate because there's three of them and only one of me. So I wanted to be with all of them. And then there was one that Tree, she's the kind of no hair one, skinny, you know, all ex-Navy. She wanted to go out and stalk in turkeys. I was like, oh, okay. Good luck. I mean, well, I'll do my best. You know, it's hard to stalk a turkey. It's like we sit still and call them in. But we did good, and we got a lot close, but nothing that we could harvest, which is unfortunate. And then the first day, the girls, I put them in a big box blind, so I knew this property perfectly. There's little like pathways where these turkeys come every single day. And the first probably 2 hours into the sit, these like three toms come walking under the blind, and they're having trouble. Like, they didn't have guns loaded or nothing, and they're like, ah, getting all like crazy, and the turkeys are gone. So they didn't even get shot off. It was unfortunate. And then we spent 3 days trying to get them turkeys. And then at the last day after they leave, I'm going to like clean up my pop-up blinds and pick up all the decoys and just clean up the property a little bit. So my buddy didn't throw me out, you know, and I'm literally pulling into the pasture, and this giant tom, probably a beard dragger, is right in front of me. And I'm literally in, I think, this shirt and like these gray like gym shorts, and I have my shotgun with me in the truck, and I'm like, okay, I'm sorry, I worked too dang hard not to walk out of here with a turkey. Park the truck, sneak around the back of it, sneak up over this little knoll, and blast this turkey. I had to. I couldn't not harvest a turkey. Oh, they were happy with me.
They're like, you couldn't have waited one more. You couldn't have called us back.
Yeah, all the hard work. We're, you know, sitting in blinds for like 9 hours, you know. They're like barely eating and drinking, so they don't have to go to the bathroom. And then they leave, and like I go in the pasture. 15 minutes later, I come back with a 10-inch beard turkey.
Well, but that, like we said on fishing, sometimes that's how it works. And hunting, that's sometimes how it works.
Exactly. crazy.
Now, you mentioned, you know, you got the show coming up, the new season. What can folks expect on the new season?
Oh, just, I mean, bigger and better. I mean, every year we're trying to go to new locations, and some of the past locations that I just love to go to, like going back down to Louisiana to go gator hunting, just in a different way this time than we have in the past. So a lot of times we were going in like early afternoon, and we hang hooks on trees with chicken on them, and then we come back the next day and check the hooks. And this year we didn't do any of that. We did a lot of just spot and stock and gators from the bank, which, man, that was so much fun, because these gators, you see them swimming along, and then you kind of just pick a point and you shoot them. If they go down, you go back, you get a little jumbo, or you try and grapple hook them from the bank. So it was a blast, man. I had that was probably the funnest gator hunt I've been on. That was going to be a good one. Costa Rica is going to be lights out. I mean, amazing. Fish after fish. New Zealand, went back over there, just got back about a week ago, right before National Music Festival here. Gosh, where else are we going? Montana, we did a fly fishing trip up there, but we didn't do like drift boats or anything like that. My buddy said, hey, I run a fishing guide service up here, but I don't want to take a drift boat, and I want to go like up in the mountains and in people's like back country of their properties and fish all these little streams and brooks and that have never been fished. And I'm like, well, I'm not a great fly fisherman, but you know, a few more pointers, I'm sure I could probably pick up on better tips. And he's one of the best, AJ Coulter, just a great guy. And man, I had a blast. I mean, walking, 20 miles a day down the streams, probably one of the funnest fly fishing trips I've ever been on. And we did a lot of great catching, man. It was so much fun. And we have to knock on people's door for permission. And I called it contraband. He was out picking like huckleberries and blackberries and blueberries and stuff all across. And he'd bring like big bags of it and say, hey, can we go fish, you know, this mile section of your river on your property? Here's some huckleberries, you know. I'll be a huckleberry. We went, and that's how we'd get to go fishing. You know, if they said no, we moved on. But I think 9 out of 10 people said yes. So it was really, really fun.
Well, sounds like an amazing season. And we're talking about, too, how you've been working on some music and you got some songs out. Mm-hmm. I guess, like you said, working toward an album for that, too.
Oh, yeah. Constantly work on that. And with the way that everybody has to deliver music this day and age, I feel like you have to be recording every month, you know, 3 or 4 songs a month to feed the beast. You know, it's crazy. Where it used to take a year or two to get a song up the charts, now it's not up in like 24 weeks, man. It's done. I'm like, gee, that's crazy. And you put so much love and effort and money into recording these songs, and I feel like the industry is going to disposable music, like vehicles these days. It's like everything's disposable, and it's nothing has that longevity. So I'm trying to do something a little different, to where, you know, I'm releasing them in ways and not always full production stuff. I'm working on kind of more of a songwriter album, songs that people will never ever, they just won't see the light of day, just because they're not the commercial, you know, what people want to hear or whatever. So hopefully that does pretty good. It gives people an insight to how I like to write songs. They're very cowboy songs. I'm not a cowboy in any way, shape, or form. You know, I'm just a country boy, but, you know, I write with some of the most amazing songwriters in town that have been here for many, many years, and they're all cowboys, and it's real fun to write with those guys. Man, it really is. Take the countryside, and we all intermingle, right? It's all part of the same. So
exactly.
My cowboy hat doesn't have the full rim around it. It only got one rim.
Well, it works, though. It works. And I know by the time this comes out, it'll be close to the end, but you've got a giveaway with the Sportsman Guy that wraps up at the end of the month, too.
Yeah, you know, we're always trying to do some stuff with those guys. Sportsman's Guy is one of my favorite sponsors. They get it, you know. They have a great online presence. You can get anything there, dude. I mean, I just got a log splitter and a wood chipper. We had a storm blowing through here, and I just bought this property, and, man, it seems like half the trees fell over. So I'm out there chopping and splitting and chipping wood whenever I can. And I didn't know that you could just have them shipped right to your house. They come in like this big wooden crate, and boom, they're ready to go. It's pretty wild.
Anything can get delivered at any point, and it's amazing what can happen. And then,
yeah,
I know too, like you mentioned, you do the USO tours, all that. You know, you do a lot of charity work, a lot of humanitarian efforts, work with the military. Why are those type of things so important to you too?
Man, I mean, that's just something I started doing at a young age. Obviously, it's kind of where the music took off, was giving back. You know, if people needed some entertainment, we were there to give it away, and we kept doing that over the years, and you know, finally got to the point where music was paying for itself, and I knew that I still wanted to keep giving back wherever I could. And there was a few organizations that really were near and dear to my heart, the military being the one, the most, that was, you know, calling out to me to go do something, because I didn't serve. You know, my dad and my uncles and a lot of my cousins were all in the military. I mean, it goes back to Vietnam and further back than that. I feel like some of them haven't come back from Vietnam. They're still going through some stuff, but it's just something that I wanted to do it, felt led to do it, but then it just didn't pan out that it was in the cards for me. So I knew that I wanted to give back in some way, shape, and form whenever I could. And these tours started popping up, and I've been going overseas for the last 13 years playing for our servicemen and women over Memorial Day. So we'd go a week before and stay a week after, and trying to shed some love and take people out of their brain space for a while. We call it kill the groundhog over there, you know, because things can get pretty monotonous, you know. And not being close to loved ones is a tough thing. I can't imagine some of these guys and girls are over there for 8, 9, 10, 12 months at a time, and more sometimes if they re-up and opt out for different things. So it's the least I could do, you know. I feel like it's the minimum, unfortunately, but can always do more, but I try and do as much as I can.
Well, like you said, you've been able to make some amazing connections, and that I'm sure has helped out there as well. And like you said, the when this episode drops, your show will be starting the new season. You're working on some new music. So Do you ever take time off, or are you always busy?
No, I don't think we ever have any time off. You know, if we're going somewhere, like when we went to Belize and started that festival, it was a selfish reasons too, because we wanted to go back to Belize more often. And we'd go down like a week before the festival, not only to start setting it up, but, you know, just to have a little downtime of our own. You know, we're trying to hopefully get a property down there so that we can, you know, frequent it more. Have a place to stay that doesn't cost a fortune. But yeah, I mean, it's usually just tacking on a day before or a day after to kind of decompress from what we've been doing. I don't think there's ever any downtime, especially, you know, now that I've got Christmas tours and stuff going too. You usually take off Thanksgiving and Christmas when you're touring, though you don't do anything. But now I'm ramping up, you know, it's like, oh, tour season is all year long now.
Well, it's a good thing. People still want to hear your music, and they still want to, you know, see your shows. So, you know, that's a good thing. And obviously, we're about halfway through the year. What's the rest of 2023 look like for you?
Oh man, it's literally so busy. I leave for Saskatchewan to go up to Ena Lake Lodge. I don't know if you're familiar with that place. This place is a fishing dream, man. You have to fly into Edmonton, Canada. Edmonton, yeah, I think that's just what it is. Edmonton, Canada. And then you take a little like commercial flight to another spot where then you get into float planes and you just, you know, you're popping around to all these cool little lakes and staying at a lodge at night, popping off to another lake in the morning. And some of these lakes have never been fished because the Ena Lake Lodge like owns all these lakes, and it's a private lodge that, I mean, you have to pay a lot of money to go fishing, and it's just incredible. I mean, pike and stuff are just, my hands are way off screen, dude. They're huge. So a friend of mine actually owns this lodge, and he's like, hey, you want to come up and do an episode here? I'm like, yeah.
Yeah.
So we're going up there. I'm bringing my cinematographer with me. It's going to be a beautiful episode. And then I'm back in town for another week or so. We got a bunch of shows throughout the summer, festivals and casinos and whatnot. And then I go back to Alaska to Bear Creek Lodge, I believe. It's a songwriter event that there's some, you know, some regular fishermen going up to this other place, but then they bring songwriters come up, and then we fish with them all day, and then we perform with them around the campfires at night. And this one is very similar to the Saskatchewan thing, but we're all staying in like wall tents, you know, on the river or on the lake. And I can't wait to do that one because we're still like popping in with float planes to all these little places. And then I'm going to Hawaii to hunt axis deer in Lanai. Scuba diving trip somewhere we haven't decided yet. I think it might be down to the Roatan. Go down scuba diving. And then, you know, planning the new festival for next year, the Songwriter Festival in Belize. And then we just got asked. I got asked today. It's like, hey, I hear your Songwriter Festival is really successful. You want to do one here in Costa Rica? I'm like, oh, it's opened up a can of worms, man.
Well, then it's just travel. You just do, it's just vacations.
Yeah, it's like episodes, all these places. And I hope they're all successful, but, you know, everybody's trying to outdo the other person. They're like, oh, well, ours will be way more successful than that one. We got so many more people that'll come, you know? I'm like, yeah, okay. Let's try.
So like you said, you're staying busy.
Very, very busy. It's busy enough, right? You know, you don't want to, I guess it's better to burn out than fade away, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Now see, I'm supposed to go next year at some point up to British Columbia.
Cool.
Up in Canada. Have you ever been there? You got any advice for me up there?
I have absolutely no advice for Canada whatsoever, man. Saskatchewan will be the first real like Canadian trip I've done. I've done some music festivals in Prince Edward Island, but that's like, I consider that still Maine, you know. it's Canada, but not far from Maine, you know. So that's as far. I don't know anything about Canada.
of all the places literally just north of us, and you've not been there.
I know. It's America's attic. You never go in the attic. anymore.
Now you're never going to be invited back. I'm just kidding. They're too nice. They'll invite you back.
I know. I'm trying to get Trudeau. Get rid of Trudeau. I'll come all the time.
Well, Lucas, dude, this has been a blast. Thanks for sharing a drink, talking music, trips, fishing, hunting, all that. I appreciate it as always.
Yeah, man. No, call anytime and share some bourbon. Maybe I'll break out the tequila next time. I got the bottle of tequila. I can't even picture the. But comes in a, somebody sent it to my wife as a gift. I know, right? Another dude. My wife a gift. No, a business associate. And it comes in this like white and blue box. And man, this stuff is delicious. I mean, I'd have to go look at the name and I'll text it to you. But I was like floored how good it was. Super smooth. Super smooth.
Now, see, speaking of tequila, so I can't stop the episode because we're talking tequila now.
Go on, man.
Was not a huge
30, dude. We got lots of time, son.
I was going to say, see, I was never a huge tequila fan. My wife loved it. Well, she still does. But she always had Blanco and, you know, finally got an Añejo the other day. Thomas Rhett's tequila.
Okay.
Aged for like 13 months in bourbon barrels. Whew, smooth.
Really? I have not tried his stuff. I'll have to check it out. You know what it's called?
Dos Primos, two cousins.
Okay.
Because it's him and his cousin, and the Añejo is, like I said, aged 13 months and used bourbon barrels, and it's got that like vanilla from the bourbon.
Okay.
So it's smooth. It's not like that instant burn of like a Blanco tequila, and then it's got the little, you know, the tequila down the throat. But it was smooth and vanilla. It was like, whoa, this isn't right.
You have to check it out for sure. I love it. Absolutely. I'll go get some tonight. Well,
there you go.
Maybe not. I've had a couple of these. So.
Well, hey, like you said, maybe you can get it delivered.
Out here, I don't. I literally, I sold my place in Nashville and we moved out to Columbia, which is great. I love it out here. It's peaceful. It's quiet. It was getting pretty rough where we were at. We were off in the Creve Hall area of Nashville. And, probably once a week, we had the police helicopters kind of like circling our neighborhood. And we'd have gunshots going off. I'm like, hey, guys, I think it's time to go. Like, that is our sign.
Sometimes you just know. Sometimes you just know. I've got a few stories that I can tell you about where I lived at one point in southern West Virginia. It's been mentioned on another episode. I don't think I need to mention it again, but you got to be careful where you live sometimes.
You really do. So do.
But there is something to be said about having a little bit of property, a little bit of space.
Yeah, it calms you down.
Absolutely.
It's pretty crazy and stressy in the growing up on that town of 44 people. It's like I'm starting to revert back to it. If I could go back, I'd probably do an RV. But yeah.
Well, dude, I appreciate it. I will give you a cheers as we go out, and thanks, man. This was fun.
Find more from Hops and Spirits at hopspirits.com.
Thanks, everybody. Bye.